Attila caught me here because he is a happy blues singer and I'm a happy blues jazz musician. We don't have connection with our keynote, I understand. You know, there he is, Professor Chomsky. Can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Very good.
Well, can you hear me?
Yes, very well. We go a long way back. You may not even remember, but you sent over the years often students who wanted to study your propaganda model to this guy in Amsterdam who was a radical leftist communication researcher. So I got all these students from the most dangerous man in America. And thanks to that, I became the most dangerous man in the Netherlands. I don't think you need a lot of introduction, but let me briefly introduce the live panelists that are at this table, or rather ask them to introduce themselves. Alicia.
My name is Alicia Fall. I am Eastern Band Salagi Cherokee and Dutch on my mother's side. I'm Cuban Taino, Spanish, and a whole mixed bag of other things on my father's side. I'm a born and raised New Yorker. I'm the founder and vision holder of Her Many Voices Foundation. The Her makes reference to Mother Earth, the many voices, all of her children. Not just us, all living beings. And we provide practical education and resources for underserved communities. My primary focus is Mother Earth, women and children, and indigenous communities.
Thank you, Alicia. John, please.
I'm John Liu. My father was Chinese. He passed away 3.5 years ago at 99. My mother is American of Scottish descent, and she is still with us at 103. And I have been a journalist working for CBS News for a decade, and then Radio Televisione Italiana and Zweites Deutsches Fernsehen for another few years. And for the last almost 30 years, I've been studying ecology. I'm ecosystem ambassador for the Common Land Foundation, based here in the Netherlands. And I am the founder of the Ecosystem Restoration Camps movement, which over the last 5.5 years has created more than 50 camps around the world to restore ecosystems.
Thank you, John. Melanie.
Hi. So I'm Melanie Ryback. I'm also American, but I considered myself about 20 years ago, I think, a political refugee right after Bush 2, and moved to Amsterdam because I love it here. So yeah, I am an ICT person, so a little different maybe than some of the panelists, but I have accidentally stumbled into social enterprise, nonprofit business models, steward ownership, and post-growth. So I have been running for the last few years a incubator that incubates startups with nonprofit and steward-owned business models. And I've also, we're launching in January the post-growth entrepreneurship class at the University of Amsterdam, and 120 students are enrolled. It's hit its enrollment cap, so happy about that.
Thank you. Professor Chomsky, those are your fellow panelists. And now the floor is to you for the introductory notes. Please, take the floor.
I should say that I'm reading the transcript because I can't hear. So if I'm a little slow, that's the reason. Well, there's no need to review for this audience the severity of the current crisis. So just mention two things we've recently learned. As we all know, the fate of the Amazon is critical for survival. It's been known for a long time that there will come a tipping point when the amount of moisture released is not sufficient to allow the Amazon to regenerate, return to savanna, total catastrophe for the Amazonian countries, but in general for the world. Well, we've just learned that in areas of Brazil, that tipping point has already arrived. Severe, furious discovery. We've also, in the last couple of weeks, learned that the Thwaites Glacier, Antarctica, what geologists call the Doomsday Glacier, is escaping from its mooring much more rapidly than had been anticipated. Contains about enough water to raise the sea level by about 3 meters. Leave the rest to your imagination. That's the kind of thing we discover almost every day. Well, let me say something that sounds completely crazy, hyperbole. The only justification for it is that it's true. The next few months may turn out to be the most important in all of human history. There's a reason for that. There are two elections coming up. One in Brazil, where the crucial issue for us is the fate of the Amazon. The other is in the United States, where there's a strong possibility that Congress will be taken by the Republican Party, which is 100% committed to denialism. Either global warming isn't happening, or if it is, it's none of our business, doesn't matter. That's the leadership. Well, if these elections turn out the wrong way, we may be on an irreversible path to disaster of unimaginable scale. Whatever the outcome, what comes next, we have to face the real world, no illusions. There is a narrow window in which action can be taken to overcome the immediate environmental crisis, to move on to a better, more livable world. It's a narrow window. Second point is that we have just experienced 40 years of unleashed savage capitalism, a major class war with many deleterious effects. One of them, that it's a virtual death sentence for the species because of its impact on the climate. Therefore, it must be leashed. Well, here we turn to questions of time scales. The crisis must be overcome within the framework, the basic framework of existing institutions. It becomes clear when you think about the time scale of what is necessary to keep that window open and what is necessary to bring about significant changes in the nature of the social economic institutions. Doesn't mean you abandon work to change them, but you cannot hope to do so to the extent that we might want within a time frame sufficient to overcome the current crisis. Well, if we fail to do that, nothing else is going to matter. So we have to succeed in that. Well, there are huge problems. They're imminent. The reaction cannot be delayed. Another aspect of reality is there are no magic keys, just the old lessons. They can work as they have in the past with diligence, commitment, understanding of the situation that we face. It's not easy. One task is to ensure that the general population comprehends the severity of the crisis that we face. Well, when you look at the evidence about this, not very encouraging. So in the United States, for obvious reasons, the most important country in the world, there is a regular study group at Yale University carries out regular studies of popular attitudes and the climate. The most recent one, the structure was asking people, presenting people with 29 choices of issues that they regarded as urgent in the coming election. An election, again, which may determine the fate of the world. So what are the what are the answers? Well, they divided them into Democrats and Republicans. Among Democrats, it was the question of climate change, which was one of the 29, had a fairly positive, insufficient, but at least fairly positive recognition. Among Republicans, very likely to take Congress in November. Among moderate Republicans, it was close to the bottom. Among conservative Republicans, it was 29th out of 29. Well, that's one of many indications of the scale of the educational problem. It cannot be ignored unless there is overwhelming popular comprehension of the severity of the crisis. We will not be able to move forward. Well, let's assume that with real effort, that gap can be overcome. Then come the problems of organization and of action. And action has to be carefully geared, carefully thought out, not to be what makes us feel good, but to be what brings people to comprehend that they must join us. That's a constant problem in every issue with people who are devising tactics. Easy to miss the significance and to do what just feels good, rather than, even if it alienates people, rather than to bring them on to join us in confronting this crisis, as can be done within a narrow window. Enormous challenge can't be avoided.
Thank you, Professor Chomsky, for pointing out the severity of the environmental crisis, but also pointing out the limited time frame that we have and the fact that we have no choice. Let me ask the panelists here at the table to react to this notion of enormous urgency that Noam Chomsky pointed us at. Alicia.
You know, it's very clear we are out of time. We keep hearing that over and over again. The only way we get back on track is if we remember how we are all connected and we work together. You work together, you rise together. This is an urgent time. We are out, completely out of time for these kind of things. One of the things that Hermeni Voices is doing now, we are focused on creating, it's a template, of hemp longhouse communities. These communities go back to the old traditional ways. It's indigenous wisdom for modern challenges. Each and every one of us come from tribal peoples. If we go back to how our ancestors lived, where we have communities, now we call them intentional communities or agrihoods. Going back to those kind of communities where we are tending to the land together, we're taking care of each other together, we're tending to the animals, we are having less of an impact on the environment in general, it makes a world of difference. These are the kind of things we have to do today. Not talk about it another 50 years and think about how we can maybe possibly do something. We need to act on these things today. We have all the information. We have all of the tools and the abilities to do these things in this moment. It's a question of just doing it. Our core value for Her Many Voices is whatever I do for another, I do for myself. The same is said, whatever I do to another, I do to myself. We have to keep that in mind, how connected we are with each other and all that there is to life.
Thank you. John.
Well, thank you, Professor Chomsky. It's wonderful to see you here. I would say that in my experience now working with restoration, first in the upper and middle reaches of the Yellow River in China, I've seen that actually we can restore large-scale damaged ecosystems. And this is exactly what we need to do in order to restore harmony with Earth systems. And I would also say that it's not the Earth that's in trouble, it's human civilization that's in trouble. So what we can do is that all who understand this issue, all who understand the urgency, can work together, as you said, quickly. We need to restore biodiversity, biomass, and accumulated organic matter, because this is how the evolutionary succession has created, constantly filtered and continuously renewed, the hydrological cycle, the weather, and the climate. And that simultaneously, we have to worry about the collapse of the existing social systems and governance systems and financial systems. So I would recommend creator spaces, central kitchens, and cultural stages in all communities so that we can come together, we can play together, we can be joyous together, we can feed each other, take care of one another. And in doing this, we can do the real work. So I would say, the organizers here have been talking about no more blah blah. So we can't talk about it, we've got to do it. We've got to restore the soils, we've got to restore the vegetation, we have to re-regulate the climate, and in doing that, we can ensure human rights for the people and justice for everyone in the world.
Melanie, now it's up to you.
Thank you. So, look, I used to be an assistant professor of computer science, and I spent a good portion of my career building privacy-enhancing technologies to protect us from Google, Facebook, Amazon. I learned somewhere throughout my career that building technological band-aids for business model problems didn't work. And I am now of the conviction that we need to fight business models with business models. But the problem is that those of us who are idealistic, who want to build social enterprises to change the system on a more structural level, wind up at impact incubators who then push us towards impact VCs, who with their standard 2 and 20 fee structures tell us that we still need to grow exponentially, maybe a little bit less, you know, and then we will sell our B corporations to Unilever. You know, thus also continuing to not solve the problem. It's the same thing with ESG, you know, in finance and investment, right? You know, we have the E, which is mostly just metrics and measurements. We have the S, which is a little less popular, but you know, it gets a bit of attention. And the G is the orphan child, it's the dust under the rug. You know, if we can take care of the G, those governance structures, the E and the S will come for free. And yet we mostly ignore that G because it's the hardest to greenwash with. So what I want to do is call to people's attention the conflicts of interest that are inherent in our business educations, in our startup incubators, and show that there are alternatives that can eliminate the financial extraction from both business and finance, and we need to. Because the incentive structures are everything. The incentive structures, that financial extraction for the 1%, this is the reason why we're externalizing costs onto society. It's the reason why we're externalizing costs onto the environment, you know? And it's not until we fix these incentive structures that we're gonna get different outcomes.
Professor Chomsky, let me get back to this issue of urgency. This climate week in Amsterdam is also meant to mobilize people. And as you said in your presentation, how do we get people to join us? That's one of the tasks of this week, to get people, and particularly those who are totally indifferent to what happens. How do we get them to be mobilized? And the question is whether focusing on the urgency is the most productive way to get people to mobilize us. I mean, if I listened well to you, it scares the living daylights out of me, what you say about the Amazon. But that may also have a paralyzing effect on people, couldn't it? That people say, well, if it's so serious, and if in the next 4 months almost the destiny of the planet will be determined, why would I just not go fish and look at my television set?
The way, that's a very natural reaction. It's hopeless, let's give up and watch television. The way to overcome it is to show people that there is something to do. Here is what we can do. So suppose you're in, I'll reiterate what I said before, the coming 2 months may be the most significant months in human history. Can't overcome that. That's particularly true for citizens of the most powerful country in the world, the United States, and the richest, most powerful country in Latin America, Brazil. For them, it is critical that they dedicate themselves to ensure that these two countries don't go over the tipping points. If they do, their consequences could be disastrous. And it's very uncertain what will happen. It's even in Brazil, it's even possible there might be a military coup. That's not ruled out. This is going to require attention, commitment, dedication, not only for Brazilians, but for the entire world, to make sure that what happens in Brazil will not destroy the Amazon, the indigenous people living in it, the role of the Amazon in preserving life on Earth. That's urgent. In the United States, there's a comparable problem, ensuring that there will be an opportunity to pursue the options that are available. And here you can lay them out. We have detailed proposals of feasible measures to address the urgent crisis. Can't get them through Congress. You've just seen this. We've seen a couple of months in which the president, who was President Biden, had a pretty fairly decent, insufficient, but fairly decent campaign program on the climate. Didn't come out of nowhere, came out of extensive, committed activism. Young people from the Sunrise Movement sitting in on congressional offices, demanding that action be taken, supported by a couple of people in Congress, including primarily Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, came in on the Sanders wave. Again, lots of dedicated activism by young people, all led to the point where there was moderately decent legislation, almost totally destroyed by Congress. The Republican Party is 100% opposed to anything. A couple of right-wing Democrats went along with them. That meant that the proposals were cut back to a tiny fraction of what they were, better than nothing, but at least something. Well, that tells you something very concrete that you can do if you're a citizen of the United States. And there are comparable things in every country in the world. Just have to look at them. Then comes the problem of bringing along the public, the general public, to understand what's happening. And do that, that requires, we know how to do that, requires continued daily work. Think about how other popular movements developed. say, the women's movement, the most successful popular movement of the last generation, or the anti-war movement in Vietnam, or the anti-nuclear movement. It started with people talking to each other in small groups, consciousness-raising groups, then larger groups, then actions to build up further support. It's not quantum physics. We know how to do it. Just get out and do it. Well, is there time? There has to be, or else we're finished. And then you do get to actions like Sunrise Movement, which did compel legislation to be put on the table. Similar things with Extinction Rebellion, climate strikes, the demonstrations at Glasgow outside the halls. All of these things have to go on, and quickly. We don't have time.
To just bring this back to the panel here, particularly as you're saying, let's show the people what they can do. Those who may be inclined to watch their own extinction on a television set, what can they do? We had a meeting of the foundation that I'm the chair of, the Rescue Our Future, and at one of the meetings, a young 13-year-old girl said, I desperately want to save the planet, but I don't know how. And that left us all speechless, because those are the critical questions. What to do? Let me bring this back to the panel. Alicia and John Mel, you all have experiences with that. What do we people show that they can do, following also from what Chomsky just said?
Well, first of all, I'm grateful to Professor Chomsky for the work that he has done tirelessly for all of these years. And it's a reminder of, there are many of us, as we're getting older, we can certainly sit back and go, not my problem, not gonna be here very long, you know. I might be here another 30, 40 years, but it's not my problem. Indigenous peoples, we look at things as the next seven generations. We have a responsibility, and it's in every little step. You don't have to do big actions. I speak to people regularly about, how about growing in your own little garden? It doesn't even have to be a whole bunch of land. It can be within your apartment, your little tiny studio. Get your hands in the soil. That soil is going to speak to you. It is taking those little steps and then educating your children on that. And they will in turn educate theirs. Those are the kind of actions that we can take. Instead of looking and going, I'm overwhelmed and I don't know what to do, you know? And come together, work with each other. When we talk about these intentional communities, that's exactly what we are doing. It keeps us from being so overwhelmed. There is such great need in this world. We have to work together.
There's a plan in this city to provide all the schools, the basic schools, with a little garden where the kids can see where the tomatoes come from. Because now if you ask a kid in Amsterdam, do you know where the tomatoes come from? They say, yes, from Albert Heijn, our supermarket. Yeah. They have no idea. They have never seen a chicken. They've never held a chicken in their hand. So we try to do something like that, to create that bond with Mother Gaia, in a way. John, your experiences.
Yeah, I think in my experience going beyond the Chinese experience, I went to Africa, Central America, South America, Australia, all over the world. And what I found is it's possible to restore hydrological function in like springs or streams in a few years. It takes 5 to 10 years, and it really means that you're increasing the biodiversity, the biomass, and the accumulated organic matter. And what I've seen where this is most effective is when people come together and they create food forests, or they use agroecology methodologies, there are several, or they create water retention landscapes. So this, I think, is the knowledge that people have to know, and then simultaneously they have to look for the acupuncture points on the earth. So there are places on the earth where the rivers are dying, and there you can work together from the headwaters to the sea to restore the river systems. And when you do this, everybody is engaged. I mean, it takes we have 8 billion people on the earth. Well, if all 8 billion people take this up and it becomes the central intention of human civilization, we stop talking about corporations and governance and power over others, and we talk about let's do this because there's no time left. And if the leaders don't want to do this, well, that's their problem. They can take a rocket to Mars or something and drink their own urine, but we're going to, you know, restore the Earth because this is the only planet that we know that has an oxygenated atmosphere, fresh water system, fertile soils, and amazing biodiversity. So this is what we need to do for ourselves, for our children, for future generations, for all life on Earth.
But John, all these people like Musk and Bezos who want to colonize the moon and Mars, the trouble with them is they come back. And I'd like to see them go up, but the fact that they come back is very disappointing. Melanie.
I don't think that we can adequately address the problem without addressing business and finance, because these are systemic problems. I think that I appreciate Professor Chomsky, you're pointing out US politics. As someone who lives in Europe, I'm extremely shocked by some developments that are currently happening at the moment. If you look at Texas, right now, the Republican politicians are forcing the pension funds to divest from so-called woke financial institutions. Look, I'm not a big fan of BlackRock either, right? But the point is that they are putting into place basically rules so that any investment at all in, you know, so-called ESG initiatives will be enough to get them removed from any public money. The problem here is this movement, and it's not just Texas, it's also West Virginia, Florida now also is moving in this direction. This is huge amounts of money. And what they are doing, see, this last year, there was a really inspiring case called Engine Number One. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with it. It was a small hedge fund out of California that said to ExxonMobil, hey, you know, I mean, you should really stop it with gas and oil exploration, right? I mean, you guys, anyhow, financially, you're doing poorly, but it's, you know, it's bad for the environment, the regulatory environment is hostile, and it's not getting you where you need to go. Of course, ExxonMobil had no intentions of changing, but with the minority stake that they had of roughly $200 million in ExxonMobil, they managed to replace three of the members of the board of directors with climate activists. In other words, this tiny hedge fund managed to do what generations of Greenpeace activists have not. Now, this really shook up the alt-right. And, you know, they're quick students, right? So, and of course, this now is leading to the same kind of shareholder activism now from their side. See, what they're planning on doing is taking this pension money from the red states and then giving it to alt-right investment funds. They then can take all of these shares, and by the way, these shares, it's actually our money, you know, that's wind up going into these things. And they're going to use them to attempt the similar kinds of takeovers on so-called woke companies like Disney, right? You know, who are trying to support things like LGBTQ rights or anything for the climate or, you know, basically anything that is in the direction that we want to move in. If they can succeed in doing a board takeover on a company like Disney, then they can also replace the CEO. And once they've done this, they can reallocate the entire resources of Disney towards right-wing conservative ends. I don't know about you, but this terrifies me. And on top of that, they can then make unlimited political donations back to the Republican politicians who diverted this pension fund money in the first place. You know, beyond that, you know, I think you all need, I mean, most people think pensions are really boring topics, but we need to start studying. Extinction Rebellion even has, you know, in London, a branch that is called Money Rebellion. And we need to start putting activists in the lobbies of our pension funds, not to divest, but to engage. Because we need to understand that we can bring democracy also to corporate governance, because at the end of the day, that money is ours. So really my plea for all of this, and a really concrete thing that I think all of us can do, is start to educate ourselves on the mechanism of how those financial flows work, you know, from the pension funds to the investment funds, from the investment funds to the companies, from the companies to the externalized costs with their social and environmental consequences, which then go back to the people who then, you know, have our pensions. The whole thing comes full circle. I think this is the most effective thing, as far as I can see it, that we can do.
Dear panelists and Professor Chomsky, I always get a little nervous when we talk about all these things that we can do, because it seems to me that we often try just to fix the problem and that we don't address the real problem. Remember in Rio de Janeiro in 92, this young kid, 13-year-old Suzuki, who said, "If you can't fix it, please don't destroy it." And I think we are well on our way to destroy our species. I'm not so much worried about the planet. I think the planet can take care of itself. Mother Gaia will continue to live. It's the problem that the human species is on its way to the abyss. And we may be so concentrated on all these fixes we want to do. You know, I'm not going to travel anymore. I'm going to have a solar panel on my roof. I'm going to no longer eat meat. Those are all ways of trying to fix the problem. But do they address the fact that we need to destroy the system within which all these problems occur? It's a systemic problem. And that is the great worry, I think, you know, unless in one way or another, you mentioned, you know, we are run, of course, by a predatory extractive capitalist system. And unless we find a way to find an alternative to that, I think all our fixes may be to no avail. Please, to you, Noam.
Well, I agree. I think capitalism in its very nature is a death sentence. But we happen to be living in this world. Now we have a problem. We have a brief period in which we can address the crisis with feasible means. We have a long-term goal of trying to change the fundamental system. Now, these two are not independent. Each contributes to the other, but the time scales are different. For example, if you take what was just said correctly about finance, in Republican states, there are laws being passed to prevent corporations, to prevent stakeholders from punishing corporations by pressuring them to divest from destroying the environment and to move towards sustainable goals. The legislation prevents that. Well, as long as Congress is in those hands, and state legislatures are in those hands, that's what's going to happen. The answer is short. The long-term answer is, you know, let's get rid of the system in which leads to this buying of candidates by ExxonMobil and others, which leads them to make these decisions. That's a long-term process. The short-term process is to make them stop making those decisions. That's coming up in 2 months. 2 months, we're not going to change the capitalist system. Okay. Same in Brazil. If the Bolsonaro government or something like it, maybe by a coup, is put into place, the process of destroying the Amazon, which has accelerated in the past years, will continue. And we will reach a point where the Amazon cannot regenerate. That's finished. Once you reach that point, you move on to savannah. Indigenous people are gone, and the prospects for human life, not just human life, all life on Earth, decline rapidly. Remember, we're not just destroying humans, we're destroying millions of other species at an astonishing rate. We're in the midst of what's called the sixth extinction. The fifth extinction eliminated maybe 70-80% of life on Earth. We're moving in that direction. Well, these are things we have to do quickly. Same time, we should be working on creating understanding and action to do exactly what you said, to change the fundamental system. But you look at timescales, well, we do continue with, we should continue with that. We just have to deal with the problems within basically existing institutions. The same is true on each of the issues that has been correctly raised. So they take the question of restoration. I mean, I've also seen on a much smaller scale, very effective measures to deal with that. Give you a case, I happen to live in Tucson, Arizona. There's a large Mexican-American population, quite poor, repressed, unorganized. There happens to be a poor school in the Mexican-American area, which for years was just a kind of like a penitentiary. The goal that schools are underfunded by the Republican legislature. The role of the teacher was to kill each other. What was the idea of going to college was just not even on the radar. Some people came along, started a project in which they set up a garden inside the school, got the kids to take care of the garden, expanded it to fish. Began to look into the organic relations, how the fish and the excrements and the plants could turn into a viable environment. Anyway, without going into the details, in a couple of years, the kids were working on biology, chemistry, deeply engaged in building what by now is a very luxuriant biological enterprise. No more discipline problems. Kids are going to college. Okay, that's within a couple of years of something that can be. They've also organized the community. The community is about a generation away from being campesinos themselves. They have a background in education, agriculture. Now, parents are coming in, helping out. Communities getting organized, becoming active. Well, that's how on a very small scale, you can do things which are a component of the large scale restoration that you're rightly talking about. Everywhere we look, we find things like this. We can find things we can do immediately on a small scale that encourages people to get involved more generally and move quickly towards the urgent problems of acting within this narrow window that still exists, in which we can use measures that are feasible to control the destruction, to move on to a better world. It includes all aspects of life, industrial agriculture, meat production, murderous and destructive, transportation, electrification, all sorts of things. I mean, take Arizona again, where I live. We have solar panels on our roof. The sun is shining all the time. You look around neighborhood, not a single solar panel. You got to pay, you got to complain about having $1,000 a month electric bills, but you can't put up a solar panel. One organization could take care of that. And the same is true in many places. Always small things you can do that can energize people and encourage them to move on to the larger issues that have to be dealt with quickly.
Thank you. To go back to an issue that we briefly raised, and I saw you nodding, Alicia, when I said maybe Mother Gaia can take care of herself. And since I think, you know, what we have done to her, she is royally pissed off with us. She's very angry with us, and you see that on all kinds of ways happening. So as the Pope once said, look at Mother Gaia as the loving sister who will embrace you. I don't think so. When we meet Mother Gaia, she will embrace us to crush us. So could it be that a better world that Noam Chomsky talks about would indeed be the world without the human species? Could it be? I sometimes have this naughty thought that if we are gone, the animals and the plants and the trees throw a big party and we'll say, good riddance, they destroyed the planet.
I'm not going to disagree with that comment by any means. Oh. Mother could easily shake us like fleas. Yeah. And she's giving us plenty of warning to get our acts together. Because we are having this ripple effect, not only on this planet, but further. And systemic change is key to all of it. Yeah. You know, I find it really interesting as a nonprofit. We're based in Colorado. We also have a New York office. When we are seeking monies, first of all, for indigenous communities seeking monies, we get, it was 0.2%. Now it says that it's up to 0.4% of 100% of the monies that are out there. Only less than 0.4% go to indigenous communities to do the work. We are looking at systemic change. We're not looking for band-aids. And that's what this is. When we go to the government and we go to the corporations, they're looking for us to just do the band-aids because we will continue to be under the thumb as long as we are doing that. There's always pushback as soon as I speak to them about, we have to change the whole system. This isn't about, they want to have those personal resources. They want you to be able to check off, oh, you handed out, you know, 6 bags of corn to this community, as opposed to creating, allowing us to have the system that we know that works, go back to the things that we know that work, because we have that wisdom. I would say the majority of the people here, you have that wisdom. Many of us sit, we go to nature, why? Because we need to sit and listen. Instead of deciding we know better than Mother on a regular basis, she speaks to us in every way imaginable. If you do not think that rock that you are sitting on does not have life, think again. Really sit and listen. It's those systemic changes going back to the foundation of who we are and why we are in this world that makes the difference. Not these little things that they're trying to distract us with. So we need people to go in those positions of working in the corporations and the banks and all that's controlling all of this financially. We need people to go in there to work who have an understanding and an interest in supporting and working collectively.
But from what you say, that systemic change would be based on an indigenous cosmology rather than on a colonial cosmology. So it would involve everything alive on the planet, also our ancestors and those who are not yet born. It's that broad concept. Is that what you're talking about?
Exactly. You know, and when I say indigenous, I am reminding everybody, we are all tribal people. You do not have to be Saragi, Lakota, you know, you don't have to be of a certain tribe that way from North America, which is what a lot of people go to, you know. Indigenous wisdom is just going back to what our ancestors have always taught us and how we were working lifetimes ago. Yeah.
I always understood that in one of the indigenous Indian languages in North America, the notion of what we now call decolonization basically means getting back to yourself, finding yourself again. So that's what it's all about. John, so you're nodding?
Well, I think we have a massive task. Obviously, Professor Chomsky has laid it out pretty succinctly. And time is important. And I think we need to define time, because we're probably thinking that time is now, and that this generation or the generations who are alive today have got to do something. And I think this indigenous wisdom about multiple generations and a long time, and that we're just here for a short time and we're passing through, but in our DNA, in our contribution to knowledge, to human knowledge, the sum of human knowledge, and how we can say that in language, such a huge contribution to humanity. And we need to define things. We need to define power. We need to define money. What is money? These are conceptual. We're often talking about abiotic systems. And in my research and my experiences, I'm seeing that if we stay in this abiotic world, there's a lot of things that can happen, but we're really just playing at the edges. Because the real thing that's happening is life and living our lives and ultimately dying and next generations coming. And we're not hardwired to commit suicide. We're hardwired to procreate. So we really need to think about what this means. And we need to also imagine a difference between the idea of having power over others. Where does that come from? Why would we allow this to happen? We're all representations of life since the beginning of time. Everyone who's alive, every living being that's alive is a representation of all life since the beginning of time. And so maybe this is not the end of the world. Maybe this is just our time, and we are faced with some interesting things. I mean, from China, when you say, may you live in interesting times, that's not a really good thing, you know. You really want to sit in the courtyard, look at the moon, drink warm rice wine, and write poetry, you know. But, you know, we need to define what is power. We need to realize that it's wrong to have power over others. It's wrong to want to have power over others. We have to look at money and say, well, what is money? It's an idea, it's the ability to have a symbol for it's a means of exchange, and it's a storehouse of value, supposedly, and it's a trust mechanism. Well, we're in a place now where it's really kind of impossible to trust in the economy, because you have extraction, manufacturing, and buying and selling of things. That's sort of a real economy. But it's been divided into those who have and those who don't have. And where does that come from? You know, so let's give a lot of numbers to them and no numbers to them. Well, how in the world is that happening? And then when you also realize that there's speculation between the cost and price, and interest-bearing debt, and that this is a bigger part of the economy than actually extraction, manufacturing, and buying and selling, then in fact, it's just a conceptual thing. It doesn't even exist, it's false. And the real value of the oxygenated atmosphere, the fresh water system, the fertile soils, and the biodiversity is zero in the GDP. This cannot be true. So something quite terrible is that the center of security for human civilization at this time. This is the big thing that we need to understand. And when we realize that we're going to have to, we're looking at centuries and millennia of mistakes. The biggest deserts were once the most nurturing places on Earth. So can we restore those places? Yes, it's really hard, but we can do it, and it's worth doing. And there are acupuncture points, like the giant coastal forests of California, or the coast of the eastern coast of Australia. There was 100 miles long, wide, and a much longer subtropical rainforest. Can this come back? Yes. The legacy genome is there. Yes, I've seen huge, large-scale ecosystems be restored. It can be done, if that's the central intention of human civilization. So we're arguing about abiotic systems, but we should be looking at biotic systems. We're looking at fiat currencies. We should be looking at currencies that are based on real value. And we need to give those numbers to everybody so that there is no one who is left out, because everybody is needed in this, the great work of our time. So making that possible ensures that everyone has a role to play. And if we all play together, then we're really going to have a lot more fun. And it's also going to be a lot more effective than having a few people say we're in charge because we stole it and it's ours. You know, I mean, that's not a real legal thing. You know, I stole it and it's mine. What are you talking about? So I think we have a lot to do, and we also need to define we. It almost sounds like we're saying we and that there's them. Well, there's no us and them. There's just us. And some of us are corrupt, and some of us are desperately poor, and some of us are at the edges of large degraded ecosystems and have zero human rights. What happened to them? Well, we understand what happened to them. This is genocide and slavery and colonization. And, you know, that's not even a criticism. That's just a fact. And so we have to look at it dispassionately, because I've met many indigenous people, and they're sorrowful, and they've experienced such incredible trauma over generations. And so there could be terrible anger, and yet they're philosophical about everything, and they want to survive. They are surviving. They're still here. Every one of us is still here. And so we have to say, all right, change is possible. Because actually, change is the only thing that's going to happen. Either it's going to happen because we're fighting it all the way and it's going to just destroy us, or we're going to align with natural evolutionary succession on the Earth, which has created such a beautiful planet. And if we can do that, then our children and future generations have a life. If we can't do that, then all of this is going to come crashing down. And we need to look at it. And we need to look at the architecture and the stuff that's been built and go, well, you know, that's not going to last. Those are ruins for archaeologists in the future. And tragically, the archaeologists in the future are just going to find like toxic waste dumps or something and say, what were these people thinking? We need to restore this, but we can do this. But we all have to realize there's just us, and it's our responsibility.
Thank you, John. Now. Thank you very much. You said everyone has a role to play. Now, in the preparations, we said to each other, for this panel, maybe since we have Professor Chomsky and we have great panelists, we should leave no space in a nice, undemocratic manner for the audience. But I think since we still have actually a lot of time, actually we have all the time of the world, this is so important. So if there's any one of you who wants to raise an issue at this point, or ask a question to any of the panelists or of Professor Chomsky, please do so. This is your chance.
Thank you. This has been wonderful. You know, as an environmental activist and a mom, one of the things I most struggle with is holding on to hope. So I want to know, what gives you hope? There's a lot to, but what brings you back up here? Yeah.
Thank you. Professor Chomsky, what gives you hope?
two things. One, there is no choice. You basically say, we have an option. We can say, everything's hopeless. I give up. Ensure that the worst will happen. Or we can grasp the opportunities that do exist, work hard to realize them. Maybe we'll make it a better world. It's not much of a choice. The other thing that gives me hope is to see what people are doing, to see. I happen to be visiting Brazil right now. My wife is Brazilian. To see, I've been talking to indigenous people who, as all over the world, are in the front of the struggle to save ourselves from our own lunacy, and see these people who are living in conditions of extreme danger, facing genocide and extermination, to see them struggling hard to save not just themselves, but the environment that they have sustained for tens of thousands of years, save it from destruction, bringing to the general, to the population, the need to work on this. You see poor people like that struggling all over the world. How can you not have hope? Or, for example, just take the school that I mentioned in an impoverished area of the town where I live. Shows what can be done, what people are doing. Or take the young people who sat in on Nancy Pelosi's office and were part of a movement that enabled serious climate change legislation to pass. They're all working hard. They're dedicated all over. It's more than enough to give anyone hope.
Thank you. Any one of you? What gives you hope, Melanie?
Yeah. Look, regardless of the outcome of the US and Brazilian elections, I agree very much, of course, that they're important. But I also think that I have a limited amount of control with what's going to happen with those elections. I'm American. I'm going to vote when I'm supposed to vote. But we might win, we might not, right? And if we don't get the outcomes that we want in those elections, I don't know about you, but I am not rolling over and stopping with fighting. Because it's partly, as you say, you know, Professor Chomsky, we have no choice. But it's also partly because I believe there are so many things we haven't tried yet. Here's the thing, you know, each of us have our own unique skills, right? We can think global, act local, think big, build small, you know? And I think that necessarily, in order to make the change that we want, it needs to be decentralized. It needs to be many of us implementing our own small, local actions within the scope in which each of us live. Which means that I really think we need to make sure that people are equipped with the tools to be able to realize, first of all, that we have that, not just the responsibility, but the ability. And secondly, to understand the mechanisms by which we can start our own initiatives and keep them running. Now, the thing is, most activistic initiatives are usually nonprofits, NGOs. But the problem, though, is they don't always have sustainable financial models. They are dependent on subsidies and grants oftentimes, and particularly now with the politics going in the direction that it's going, these sources are drying up. And yet, if an NGO wants to move over to a more sustainable financing source, like let's say creating a business, you know, to help support then its operations, this NGO is at a risk of losing its charitable status by the tax authorities, which is, you know, sort of the death knell for an NGO at that point, because if they lose their charitable status, then the donations are no longer tax deductible. And this is a life and death situation for NGOs. And thus, those with the good intentions are sort of pigeonholed into this corner. But the problem here is our conception of the entire word profit, right? We all think that we understand what the word profit means. but do we? The first definition of the word profit is what I would call sort of, you know, reinvested margin. So if I do something for you and then you pay me for that, then I get to pay my staff and I get to put some money into building the organization. That margin that's reinvestable, that's one definition of the word profit. The second definition of the word profit is financial extraction. In other words, my Lamborghini and my private jet, you know. But the problem here is that these two words, so the reinvestable margin and the financial extraction, are embedded into the same word. So we complain about the system, but the system is embedded into our very language, and this makes things confusing, because then if people say, well, of course my company needs to be profitable, you know, to survive. If you're talking about reinvestable margin, sure. If you're talking about financial extraction, not only do I disagree, but it's a disadvantage on the competitive market. But the point is, for nonprofits, this makes things equally confusing. Because when you say that something is not for profit, of course the NGO wants to eliminate the financial extraction. That much is obvious. But the fact that they then also feel that they're not allowed to have reinvestable margin, that's the problem. And we have the same issue also with the triple bottom line of social enterprise. People, planet, profit. That actually turns into people, planet, reinvestable margin, extraction. And that extraction is the greenwashing. So we need to understand that if we want to create sustainable organizations that can fight for change in an activistic fashion and yet support themselves financially, we need to get rid of the financial extraction from everywhere. Because at the end of the day, we can stay in the margins, accepting donations, which is a tiny fraction of the budget coming from corporations and governments. And then there's the procurement budget, and that's all going to the big four, you know, and McKinsey's of the world. Screw that. Let's build, you know, the alternatives. Let's do it local, and let's fight with non-commercial entities on the commercial market. It's a better value proposition. Ethics also does actually have market value. Let's make sure the extraction is out of it, and let's win.
Well done. Alicia, what gives you hope?
I love this question about hope, and I smile. I'm actually, prior to doing this work, I was a full-time musician, and I wrote a song, Hope is What We Got. And, you know, the first line is, when she came into the world, hope is what she got. And that feeds me on a regular basis. There's a phrase, particularly within indigenous communities, we say, they thought they buried us, but we were seeds. And so I look at this and I think, in that seed, in that darkness, in that we are being nourished by mother and tended by love and intent, right? Positive intent. Those are the kind of things that give me hope. Absolute hope. John, you spoke about, you know, we're in this, it's kind of a genocidal thing that we're in the midst of. Back home, I sit on the board of Colorado. I'm going to get this phrase right. I've lost myself here. I sit on the board for Colorado's Coalition Against Global Genocide. It's a full mouthful. And these are the things we talk about. We talk about the environmental genocide as well. There are so many young people that I know that are tending to their own personal gardens as well as their physical gardens in their backyard. This is the kind of hope that feeds me on a regular basis. You know, looking at that, and you think, oh my God, there's so much. It can be overwhelming, and you feel like I'm in the darkness. Just know that you are that seed, and you are being tended to, and you are being nurtured, and you have the ability to come into this world and then continue that to the next. So that's the hope I have for your children as well as mine.
Was there another question? Okay.
Thank you. I have more of a comment that may or may not end up in a question. We'll see where it goes. But I wanted to pick up sort of on what John and Alicia had said earlier, sort of about going back to the baseline, the fundamentals. Alicia, you talked about the ancestors or planting the seeds, and John, you talked about the language. And I was wondering, I live in Cape Town, South Africa, and in Cape Town, it's very common to hear people talk about the ancestors or their traditions, and whenever people talk about their lives today, they're always invoking generations that came way, 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 thousands of years before. And in the US and other parts of the West, we've had an assault on the humanities, which in the US at least, I think books and literature and music is where our sources of inspiration come from. And so when I hear the panel talking a lot about we need to change the system or we need to revamp the system, I'm often left with the question, you know, to what? Replace it with what? And so as much as we're in a crisis of urgency, I also feel like in the West we're in a crisis of imagination. And so I'm wondering if the panel and Professor Chomsky, if you all could maybe comment a little bit about how the assault of the humanities in the West is maybe hampering our ability as a culture to deal with the climate crisis.
That's a very interesting question. The United States happened to be in the lead in creating mass public education, late 19th, early 20th century, very successful. If you look at the percentage of kids in the United States who went to high school, it was far higher than Europe. Europe didn't catch up for a long time. And schools were, many of them, wasn't everywhere, were progressive. They were trying to encourage creativity, imagination, common efforts. It raised the level of the culture, the general culture, significantly. It was a major phenomenon. The last basically half century, it's been going backwards. It's been business models as part of the neoliberal assault on the population. Business models were imposed on the universities. Schools are defunded. There's effort to destroy the public school system, to turn everything to basically training people to work in business. That's it. Now it's taking in a really extreme form with the leading elements of the Republican Party who want to remove books from libraries, prevent children from reading them, make sure that nobody studies history, nobody studies the humanities, that you just learn patriotic slogans and then learn how to work on your job and be obedient. Well, it's a sharp, it's quite ironic considering the role of the United States in initiating successful mass education. So we're back to the same point. All of this is part of a 40-year assault, a kind of bitter class war, just has to be reversed across the board. You're quite right in the nature, in the crucial nature of bringing young people to an understanding of the wealth of the cultural tradition that's been created over many millennia, introducing them to other cultures. The United States happens to be an unusually insular society. So learning about the culture of indigenous people, the people we mostly exterminated, other cultures, all of that's essential to having, creating a community of people who will be willing to understand the needs of others, to cooperate with others, to help create a better world for all of us, and to deal with the specific issues we're facing. If you just train students to do your job and follow orders, nobody's going to get involved in the kinds of things we're talking about. It's the idea, the plan to destroy public education is perfectly understandable. on the part of those who own and run the society. Yes, that has to be combated at every level.
Alicia, on imagination.
First, I would highly recommend that you do not follow the US so much. Okay. Just across the board. You know, I look at things like, and I'll be speaking about this later on this week, I speak on hemp and humanity. We took a plant that was readily available and we made it illegal. Beyond insane. That is a terrorist act. That's a genocidal act. We can bring this plant back into the fold and let it be because Mother knows best, not us. And yet, when we bring it back into the fold slowly, we're trying to manipulate the plant. We need to address things like that. John can speak to this as well. Simple things like we hear now this no-till to the soil. There are some very basic things that we get to do that bring us back to where we need to be in moving forward. Very simple things that can change this whole trajectory. You know, when I look at hemp, I think about, yes, we should continue to replant trees because God knows we are destroying, right? A tremendous amount. But when you look at a plant like hemp, it will carbon sequester up to 5 times greater than the trees. That tree is gonna take maybe 10 years, maybe 150 years to become mature. That hemp plant is going to mature in somewhere around 100, 120 days. And yet it's going to carbon sequester 5 times greater than the tree that we're planting. So there's some very basic things we can look at and make some little adjustments. Go back to the full biodiversity. Every time we remove one thing out of the equation, it completely throws us off kilter. I hope that answers a little bit of what you're asking.
Well, I see that there's some other questions or comments. I would just say that this education idea, I've noticed that my education took place outside. And telling people to sit down, stand up, come here at this time, leave at this time, and be quiet and listen or read this book is not what I think of as education. It's more like socialization. And I think what we're engaged in now, given the shortness of time, is collaborative inquiry for collective intelligence. So that if we all work in teamwork to address, like, if you think it's so impossible to restore a river system, or if you think it's impossible to bring back a forest, well, I can tell you it's not. It's doable. And we need to do that. And so if we all do that together, we can study everything. We can study classic literature if we want to, and it tells us exactly the same thing, as do the sacred texts, as do the indigenous wisdom. So that's enough for me, but I don't know.
Another comment.
Oh. Yeah, it's working. Yeah, thanks. Thanks a lot. I'm very emotionally loaded, so I hope I can get my thoughts straight. I really love the interplay of the different perspectives, right? The business perspective. I work in business too. It's not fun. The indigenous perspective, the political perspective, and I love to hear that it's possible to restore ecosystems. And thanks for your questions. Yeah. So I'm with Extinction, we're here with Extinction Rebellion in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam. And so I just want to pick up on the hope thing again, because it's also a big question, right? Like, what do we do, and, you know, why do we do it? And we just kind of came to a point where we said, like, okay, it's pretty bad. It's probably not going to work. But at least we tried. So that's somehow the point where we came to, because just looking at, okay, is it going to work or not? It's a very intellectual way of looking at the problem. And if you look at it that way, yeah, it's just crushing. So that's why, you know, when I say this to myself, I wouldn't ask you to have hope. Instead, I would ask you to have faith. Because, well, if I think about what gives me hope, and then I think about what crushes that hope, well, yeah. So that's just, yeah, a bit all over the place. But yeah, that's just what I wanted to share. And maybe now towards a question. So, so what I've learned in being an activist now for about 2 years is that there sometimes seems to be a little bit of a conflict between, like, you know, the individual missions and the individual initiatives versus then actually taking a collective initiative or taking collective action. And what I've learned that is because taking collective action requires sacrifice. Just thinking about some of the organizers of this Action Week or some of my fellow activists, right? And now, yeah. So what do you think, right? Like, how can we kind of work towards more collective action when it requires the sacrifice, right? So John might say, okay, let's all work on ecosystems. And you might say, okay, let's all work on business, right? So what's your take on this collective action aspect? And how can we maybe combine that?
Good, thank you. You look at me as if you want to give an answer to that, Melanie.
Well, I mean, I think that in the end, we all kind of need to follow our own North Stars. And sometimes it'll be individual and sometimes it'll be collective. And I think some people more have the temperament for individual action and other people more have the temperament for collective action. And I think we need both. But one thing you were saying, though, was sort of the struggle that you're having also just with the spiritual need to get things done. And I think it ties in very well with the previous question about the cultural aspect and how we've also gotten divorced from that. The problem is that we've created these chasms, both in ourselves but also in society. So on the one hand, I mean, you've got the, as I would sort of put it, you've got the rationalists, and then you've got the creatives, you know? And oftentimes, they don't like hanging out together. and the thing is, we also tend to separate ourselves into those camps, too. Either you're rational or you're creative. You can't be both. Of course, Sir Ken Robinson made a wonderful TED Talk about the education system and the role that has in pushing us either to be creative or to be rational. But this, I think, is one of the things at the heart of the problem. Because I think that creatives and those who consider themselves creatives need the structure, you know, and need the mechanisms and the tools to also be able to implement such creative ideas. Well, I think that those of us who are more the rationalists, we need the creatives to remind us of why. You know, and the problem is that that's not integrated into our education. You know, I am a computer scientist, right? So I'm like ultimate sort of, you know, sort of semi, you know, autistic rationalist here. Hello. But the point is that, you know, when I was going through my university education, you know, we just learned how to do it. We didn't learn why. And if you ask most of the students, what are you going to do when you grow up? They're all like, yeah, I want to work for Google, and I want to work for Facebook, and I want to work for Amazon. And that was sort of the definition of success that we got. And never, you know, what I do like about the U.S. education system in comparison with the Dutch one is, at least with the U.S. education system, I don't know if it changed since my university days, but there's something called a core curriculum, which is basically the sort of general broad education across multiple topics that every student gets regardless of what study they're doing. That's very different from the Netherlands, where when you're a computer science student, you're just studying computer science. Looking back at my at my undergraduate education, I was a biology major, right? And if I look now at how much of that I actually use on a day-to-day basis, I'll tell you, you know, not a whole lot. So, I mean, what I did get a whole lot out of, though, were my literature classes and that African hand drumming class that I took, and the theater class, and all those other random things, American history, that had nothing to do actually with what I was studying, but that somehow developed me and formed me as a human being. So what I think we really should look to do is find ways to also bridge those chasms? How can we create business incubators that are a combination between the typical startup, you know, Y Combinator types, and an artist atelier? Can't we just put them in the same building, you know, and shake it and mix it and have some social events and see what happens, right? You know, and I think also in ourselves, Attila also is a really great example of that, with also being a blues musician and a businessman. And, you know, I think also the more we can understand that, you know, we shouldn't separate these things out. You know, what we do for a living, you know, is also one of the Buddhist Eight Noble Spiritual Paths, right, livelihood. We can bring our spirituality together with what we do on the work floor, and we can, and we must, because if we don't, then we're done with it.
I had this, yeah, please. I had this afternoon the easiest task. I only had to keep time, and it's time. So we may not have exhausted the topic, certainly not, but we have exhausted ourselves, I think, and certainly our time. But I'd like to end with referring to a little booklet that no one will recognize, Despair, Optimism Over Despair. And in this little booklet, you say, we have to be optimistic, because otherwise we leave everything to go down. And I totally agree with you, it's a moral obligation to be optimistic. But I also see a lot of despair. We have to be realistic. I mean, we are up against an enormous, powerful system. We're up against formidable obstacles. So we can't just say, well, let's be optimistic and let's lounge until the end of times, everything will be okay. So using this little booklet, I've phrased a slightly different concept, and I'm in favor of desperate optimism. You've got to be optimistic, but with a little level of despair. But you've got to see, with Rebecca Solnit, this is Earth, it'll never be paradise. But you also need to learn from José Luis Borges, every day has its moments of paradise. And I thought this day was a moment of paradise. It also felt like being in paradise, you know, with the green around us. So thank you very much, Attila and the team, for organizing this. Wonderful. Let it be the beginning of a great week in Amsterdam, and hopefully in other cities. Noam Chomsky, thank you very much for your contribution to this panel and for your wise words, as always, much appreciated. And then the live panelists here, Melanie, John, Alicia, thank you very much. And in the name of Mother Gaia, be blessed all. Thank you.
Thank you very much for everybody. Please take a break and join our second panel. There is interesting conversations gonna go around, because we are not stopping here in Amsterdam. We're gonna start insulate homes. We're gonna start grow food in eco gardens. We're gonna plant the trees. We're gonna save the planet together, because Amsterdam is home of 180 nationalities. So the whole world is here. If we can galvanize and mobilize Amsterdam, we can do it everywhere across the world. Thank you very much, Noam. You've been a real great supporter. Thank you very much for everybody, for all the panel. Thank you for David, the 7 billion presidents, our co-organizer and the Green Revolution. See you soon, take a break. We're gonna have some music and some fun and food, and see you soon. I'm suicidal with a sense of humor. Some say I'm freaking it up, trying to start rumors. Some people say that I won't last long. Find myself a home, settle down, write a song. But I love to hang around in black people's places. Fascinating, tell me.